The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
Hi, I'm Sal. Today we're going to solve problem number 2 of test 3 of fall 2009. Now, before you attempt the problem, there are certain things that you need to know to solve the problem. One is mechanical properties of metals, and also the properties of amorphous metals, which are known as metallic glasses, and how to draw crystal structures. They're given to you. So the problem reads as follows. For a given alloy composition, explain why the yield strength of the amorphous form, the metallic glass, is greater than that of the crystalline form. Now, in order to answer this question, you want to start thinking about the mechanical properties that these two materials have. So if I look at a metal, I know that, you know, I'll call this the metal. I know that the way a metal deforms before it reaches, you know, plastic deformation, it deforms via your planes sliding past one another, so it's known as slip. So I know that metals deform via slip, and slip is facilitated by dislocations. And you should know that what dislocation is by now, which is just a line imperfection in your crystal. So slip is facilitated by dislocations. So I know that my metal, you know, it has planes that are arranged because it sits in a nice crystallographic structure, and that the slip, when it undergoes deformation, that this is actually assisted by dislocations. So having dislocations helps to form a metal. So now I want to start thinking about what a metallic glass has, or the amorphous form. So if I look at the metallic glass, and all I'm doing here is comparing the basic properties between the two, because that's what's going to get me, metallic glass. I know that for a metallic glass, there's no long range order. So the fact that there's no long range order means that these glasses don't, or the metallic glasses don't form a perfect crystal array. And that lack leads to metallic glasses having no dislocations. So if in metals, slip is facilitated by dislocations, and if a metallic glass doesn't have dislocations, then I would assume, just by comparison between the two, that the threshold for, you know, for one of these materials to yield would be due to the fact that that whether or not it has dislocations. So with this argument, I would say that the metallic glass has a higher yield strength than my metal because of this property. So that, if you did that, if you went ahead and wrote all that out for your answer of part A, you should be able to get most of the points for this problem. Now, part B, it asks, on each of the following separate drawings of one face of an FCC unit cell, FCC stands for face-centered cubic, indicate one of each of the following. So now we're going to move on to part B. And part B wants, there's three scenarios. One, it wants us to indicate on a face of a crystal a substitutional impurity. So substitutional impurity. So if I draw a face here. I can just by knowing what the definition of a substitutional impurity is, I know that it's not going to be anything that can be, you know, just embedded in between atoms, like an interstitial. I know that it's going to be a substitutional impurity. So if this is one of the faces of your crystal, and it's FCC, which is face-centered, it's on the face. The face is centered on the center of an atom on your face. Then I would say that if I substitute this out for a different atom of, you know, type B compared to these atoms, then that's a substitutional impurity, because that atom is not the same as the other. It's like having, you know, silver and gold, for example, in composition. And then it also asks for the second part. That's number one. For number two, it wants us to, you know, demonstrate a vacancy. Now, a vacancy is simply an atom missing from a normal lattice site on your crystal array. So if I draw again another face, then I can leave that blank, and I can go ahead and I can point and I can say that the vacancy is actually, you know, sits right here. So this is my vacancy, because there's no atom that's there. It moved out of its place. So that's, you know, another defect that we put in there. And for three, it has an interstitial impurity. So, what's an interstitial? Well, an atom that can fit in between two atoms of different that are different than the one that fits. So, if I draw again an FCC face, I notice that there's, you know, certain spots where an atom of a different composition can fit. And I can go ahead and I can just put a, assume that's an atom of a different composition, and that can very simply be your interstitial. So that that's your interstitial impurity. So knowing the definitions, you're able to answer this problem very simple. There was no math involved in this, and all you needed to know was knowledge of or mechanical properties of metals versus amorphous metals, which are known as metallic glasses. And with knowing that information, and you're able to answer a question like this, which is, you know, pretty simple after you finish it, if you think about it. Again, if you didn't know what FCC was, which stands for face-centered cubic, you could have probably lost a lot of points on this problem. But if you know that, if you know how to draw it, then you're good to go.